protocol. Just a quick note, if you are a family with young children, just for this Sunday, we are asking that you stay in worship until the end of the children's moment. Our COVID numbers are in the green zone, which means that masks are not required, but we will be maintaining physical distancing throughout the service. If you have any questions, please reach out to one of our fantastic ushers that are in the narthex. And we know that it is an FCC tradition that it is very warm in the sanctuary during these months. So if you need water, there's some water in the back. There's also hand fans because we want to make sure that everyone is staying as cool as possible. And without any further delay, let's have church.
Grace and peace to you, beloved FCC family. It is such a joy to be seeing folks coming into the sanctuary who we haven't seen from the summer, but maybe further back than that, it really does feel a little bit like Welcome Home Sunday. For after a couple years of unpredictability, this is really a time to celebrate. It feels like we are truly back. And so I'd like to extend a very special welcome to anyone who's joining us for the very first time this morning. We hope that you feel welcome among us and that while you are with us, you experience an encounter with the living God. So that is truly why we gather. And I invite you to take a look at the folks who are sharing their views with you. For the members and friends of this church are truly the ministers of this church. So if you have a need or a question, please just reach out to someone nearby or to one of our ushers, so we are all here to serve one another. Even though we've turned the corner into September, we do continue in the season the church calls ordinary time. But we are also celebrating a new season in this church, one that lifts up the wonders of creation. As we begin our year-long process of becoming a creation justice church, we attune ourselves to the rhythm of the natural world, we celebrate its beauty and power, and we give thanks for all the good gifts that surround us. And so this morning, as we share in our special blending of the waters, we will lift up the life-giving power of rivers to connect and nourish us. So in this time of worship, let us open our hearts and minds, for we gather here as seekers, not for answers, but for wisdom, not for doctrine, but for a way of life inspired by the radical love of Jesus the Christ. So let us be together now in a spirit of sacred and holy worship.
Please stand if you are able for our call to worship. Come to the water, all you who thirst. Come to the water, all you who are weary. Come to the water, all you who long for justice. For God is here among us, washing away the dust and grime of our lives, and pouring out the Spirit on all who live. Let us worship God together. Amen.
Now I'm going to invite you to continue standing as you are able, as we begin our very special tradition of the blending of the waters. Over the summer, we were each invited to gather a little jar of water from wherever our travels might have taken us. And so we have waters from pools and lakes, oceans and streams, nearby or far away. But no matter where our water was spent, it is the elemental source of life. And it is the force of life that connects us in so many ways. And so just as we blend our lives back together this morning, so shall we blend these waters. So you are asked to remain in your pew while we sing the very first verse of Shall We Gather at the River. And then once that is done, the choir will continue serenading us as you're invited to come forward and pour your jar of water into our bowl. We have two bowls in case one gets a little bit full. And as you do so, please speak the name of the place where the water has come from. You don't need to come up single file. Just come and come as you are able. And when you are done, just return to your seat. Let us come and join together the waters of life.
bless these waters together. God of creation, source of all that is, we bring before you the water of life. Just as each of us comes from our own place and past, these waters began in many different places. But just as all our paths combine in your love, so we blend these waters into one blessed pool. Pour your grace upon them, that they may be a source of refreshment and hope and a reminder of our common source, that we may be mindful of its preciousness and power. We pray this through the one who offers us living water. Amen. And I ask that you please remain standing. It's a very exciting Sunday. For a long time, we've been crushing it with the physically distanced passing of the peace. But now that we are in the green zone, we can do a face-to-face passing of the peace. So not everyone is going to probably be open to the full SCC hug. So it's all right to go with a handshake. It's okay to go with a elbow bump, and or even a foot tap. There's so many, or one more. So now let's say. There are so many ways that we can greet each other, but let's make these connections so that we can magnify the love of God in this place. The peace of Christ is with all of you.
And also with you.
Let's cast the peace.
That was beautiful to see the blending of the waters through the pews, all the way from heart to heart, hand to hand, over to over. Oh, and some more water. Bring it in, bring it in. Oh, so good morning, FCC. Welcome back. So at this time, I have a special request for all families to come on down to the steps with your kiddos, and including the toddlers and the infants, because I have a special announcement today that I want to make about our wonderful children's program, and I think it's really important for us to see the children and their parents, and for you all to come on down and take a seat on these steps, show your faces to the world here. Actually, you guys can sit. Come on down. Actually, maybe you guys get out the way and let the family sit in. Yeah. Yes, this is what I want to see. Wow. Come on down. Yay. All ages. Get their space up on top. Hi, Chloe. Hi, Layla. Yeah, go up higher so people can come in underneath you. Everyone go up a step or two. Yeah, go ahead. Make room. This is what we have to do. Make room for the waters. We're overflowing. Let's give a round of applause for families. You guys, come on in. We don't want to leave anyone out. They spot you right here. Come on in, really. Come in here. Get in there. Yes. Exactly. Right in the middle. You're right in the middle. Don't be shy here. So for those who don't know, hello. Hello, hello, everyone. I need to look into your beautiful eyes. Yes, I do. I want to see them colors too. Let me see that inner child shining through. Hello, gorgeous. Hello. I'm so happy to have you back. You see, you know what I don't look into your eyes, right? You're just going to look at my eyes. I see it. I can see it. I know. So, yes, families, we are back, and it's been a long time, all right? Because that pandemic was a big pregnant pause, right? And it got cozy at home. Did it get cozy at home? Yeah, Sunday mornings, not rushing out to church to have 3, 4 children all dressed before 10 and out the door. I know how hard it is. Let me hear an amen. Is that hard? Yes. Yeah. Another round of applause for these mothers and fathers and all that they're doing to bring their children to a sacred experience, right? And how valuable is that to have a sacred space with a community who will affirm for your children shared values in a world that is a bit chaotic and crazy and scary? That's what we're here to do, to create safe space for our children. So, next Sunday, we are having a big open house, and I hope to see at least this many parents here, and for you to grab some new ones and bring them in so that you can meet the fabulous FCC Children's Education team and learn about the new perks in our program. So, again, my name is Reverend Karma Cloud, and I'm the Director of Christian Education here. And here are two of my wonderful, I call them the angel team. I have one more, and he will be here. He might come running down, as they do sometimes, any moment now. But first, I'd like to introduce, well, you already know, Miss Sabin and Team Lisa giveaway. Yes. This year, Sabin is going to be lead teacher for the mustard seed, and we're so excited to have her here. And we also have joining our staff, Miss Andrea Vasquez, who you all know as a member of this church. She's come through, we've seen her at many stages and ages, and now here she is. She is actually a key component to my vision that I've had for a long time, especially for these little ones. The child care room is no longer just a child care room. It is the Caterpillar Corner. And your babies, thanks to Andrea's vision, are going to receive some Christian ed curriculum as well. They're going to get some story time with stories that have our shared values. They might get a little activity as well connected to that. So we are really bringing them into the fold so that they're not just, oh, child care over here. No, they're part of the program, and you're part of the program. And in order to really be a part of the program, parents, I am going to encourage you to grab one of these right here, the registration form. That we work very hard on, and we'd like to collect your important information so that we can communicate with you and keep you connected and up to date about what's going on with our program. So outside there, you will have all the information you need, and today in the guild room will be there too, okay? So I do want to just let my staff members have a word to share what they're looking forward to this fall.
Hi, everyone. I've been here for almost a year already, but I'm very excited to do new things because we are trying to organize stuff. We got the art supplies. We, like, completely redid the upstairs. It's new. We're doing new stuff, so I'm very excited to work with kids and do new things. I think it's going to be a lot of fun.
Hello, everyone. Well, I'm also looking forward to the fact that I'm back. I graduated, so I'm going to be here every Sunday now. I'm very excited that we are reforming this South Care Room, redefining our programs to for improvement and for involvement. And I'm very happy that we're able to kind of like put that seed on all of these families. And I'm looking forward to what happens.
So, let's all take a collective moment to turn towards our hearts and give thanks for the great Mother Water, the Divine Mother of Water, who brings us all together, the ocean, the mother of us all, the great womb of creation. Thank you for all of these beautiful babies that you've brought forth into this world. Thank you for all of these families. May you continue to mix and blend our waters, our spirits, our bodies, our souls, and the collective intention of creating safe, sacred space for our beautiful children to grow and become strong, full of courage, compassion, and deep faith in Christ, in creation, and in themselves. Amen. So at this time, for front row, please rise. And our little ones can come up with us, all of us. So if you would like to come and see the child to the room and leave an infant or toddler with Andrea, you may certainly do that at this time. All right? So follow Sabo and Andrea on up. We'll see you up there. For the many gifts of creation that surround us. I invite you now to stand as you are able, and we are going to share a creation creed together each and every Sunday during this season. And so let us speak this shared creed together. We believe that God creates all things, renews all things, and celebrates all things. We believe Earth is a sanctuary. The home of the earth is filled with all creatures. We sin and then suffer with hope because the crime of the earth is against creation. We believe God that the kingdom is incarnate at the heart of the earth in Jesus Christ. He lived and breathed and spoke among us. But that found us in a river, caught on a mountain, celebrated the lilies of the field, and gave his life for all people might live. We believe that the risen Christ rose the whole of creation, reconciling all things to God, renewing all things. We believe the Spirit renews life in creation, grows in empathy with every suffering creature, and roots with us in the new life. You may be seated. Now let us center ourselves, heart, soul, and mind in the presence of others. As we open ourselves in prayer for those in our community who are in need of God's loving grace. Holy One, we offer praise for Ben as he continues a journey of healing in an inpatient program. May he find strength, clarity, and comfort, and may his family continue to be supported in hope and love. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for Laura, who is recovering from surgery for pancreatic cancer, and for Lewis as he recovers from a stroke. And we pray for Darren and Debbie Allen as they care for him and in their concern and their anxiety. We pray for strength, swift healing, and comfort as they all bark on the road to recovery. Lord, in your mercy. And we lift up the family and loved ones of all who go. Genesis son, who will mark the year anniversary of his death this week. surround each of them with your comfort and peace, and that they grieve this beloved member of their family. Father, in your mercy. And, O God, we ask you to stir our hearts into action. As global temperatures increase, inspire us with ways that we can make a difference in our homes, our church congregation, communities, and the world around us. We pray for those worst hit by our changing climate. We know people living in extreme poverty around the world are worst hit and have done the least to contribute to it. So help us, O God, to find new ways to be in right relationship with the earth and one another. God, in your mercy. And on this day, September 11th, when we remember the devastation of the attack on our country 21 years ago, we mourn with those who are grieving loved ones whose lives were shattered by violence and hatred. And we search all hearts, O God, for the wisdom, the insight, the restoration that comes from recognizing our own tendencies for violence and vengeance. Create in our hearts for connection, forgiveness, and justice. May the memories of those we have lost inspire us to be agents of peace. God, in your mercy. Holy One, whenever two or more are gathered in your name, you are there. And so you are here among us, healing us, inspiring us, and gently redirecting us so that we might see the world as you do and love it with your love. And so in this time, we offer aloud any joys or concerns which rest upon our hearts this day. God, in your mercy. Holy One, you are indeed the Mother of the Father, and you have heard our prayers, those we have lifted up this morning, and those we have kept in the silence of our hearts. Hear us now as one family of faith, as we share aloud the prayer that Jesus, your Son, and our brother taught us. Our Father, O God, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
So we are moving coffee hour from the front lawn to the guild room. Let us bring a special shout out to anyone who contributed to our coffee hour, and of course to the DeCampbell family, who has made all of our coffee hours possible. We would love to see you there. I think my mic is on. Okay. Just in time to say it. The new church directory is here. The new church directory is here. Newell's Danger to make a reference to a Steve Martin movie from the early 80s. But I am that excited nonetheless because it's been a few years. Please make sure to pick up your church directory in the narthex on the way out. It's a great way to stay in touch with the congregation throughout the year. Are you looking to find ways to align your finances with your values? On Tuesday, September 13th, we are invited to join our friends at the Nick Keswick Synagogue on Zoom for an interactive conversation on how to move your personal finances away from funding fossil fuel extraction, production, and distribution, and instead see your deposits, premiums, and investments used to fund local businesses, farms, affordable housing, and development of clean energy. This event will be led by Greenpeace once again. It's happening on Tuesday over Zoom. Lunchtime Labyrinth is held each Wednesday from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. You are welcome to come and take your soul out for a walk on a beautiful labyrinth right here in the sanctuary. No experience is required. All are welcome. One of the most important factors in lifting folks out of poverty is having friendships and allies across income levels. On Wednesday, September 14th, we will be having a special Zoom information session to learn how we can help alleviate poverty through creating community. Family Promise of Essex County, formerly IBCHEN, is starting a special group of allies, advocates, and leaders called Circles of Essex, designed to help build friendships across lines of income. An email was sent out on Saturday with the details. Slow Motion Bible Study is back, led by Reverend Jenna Kafari, each Thursday evening on Zoom, starting September 15th. Please join the wonderful Bible study for an in-depth and engaging look at our scriptures. Again, all are welcome. And finally, please take a moment to fill out the green connection card so that in your bulletin, whether you are a long-time member or a first-time visitor, it matters that you are here. If you are new to us, we especially encourage you to fill out a green connection card and we would like to send you a note of welcome and greetings during the week. It takes all of us here that continue to be the beloved community that we strive to be. And one of the important ways that you can support our community is to say whether or not you can make a financial contribution. There are a number of ways that you can give. You can use our FCC giving page on our website or the QR code on the back of your bulletin. You can use the Vanco mobile app, text your gift, or give cash for check. Yes, we're coming around now. All information can be found on our website, fccmonclair.org. Thank you once again for your generosity. Scripture readings celebrate the spiritual power of water. Listen for the wisdom of God. A reading from Psalm 63, verses 1 through 4. O God, you are my God. I seek first prayer. My flesh prays for you, as in a dry and weary land where there is no water. So I have looked upon you in the sanctuary, beholding your power and glory. Because your steadfast love is better than life, my lips will praise you. So I will bless you as long as I live. I will lift up my hands and call on your name.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 44, verses 1 through 4. But now hear, O Jacob, my servant, Israel, whom I have chosen. Thus says the Lord, who made you, who formed you in the womb, and who helped you. Do not fear, O Jacob, my servant, whom I have chosen, for I will pour water on the thirsty land, and streams on the dry ground. I will pour my spirit upon your descendants, and my blessing on your offspring. They shall spring up like a green cabbage, like willows by flowing streams.
A reading from the Gospel of John, chapter 4, verses 10 through 14. Jesus answered her, if you knew the gift of God, and who it is that is saying to you, give me a drink, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water. The woman said to him, sir, you have no bucket, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our ancestor Jacob, who gave us the well, and with his sons and his flocks drank from it? Jesus said to her, everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But those who drink of the water that I give them will never be thirsty. The water that I will give them will become in them a spring of water, gushing up to eternal life.
A reading from the Book of Revelation, chapter 22, verses 1 through 5. Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, bright as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb to the middle of the street of the city. On either side of the river was a tree of life, with 12 kinds of fruit, producing its fruit each month. And the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nations. Nothing accursed will be found in there anymore, but the throne of God and of the Lamb will be in it, and his servants will worship him. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads, and there will be no more death. They need him no light of lamp or sun, for the Lord God will be their light, and they will reign forever and ever. May God have wanted you to yield to the mystery of his word.
Pray with me. Gracious God, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, our strength and our redeemer. Amen. In a poem called River Clarion, Mary Oliver writes this. I don't know who God indicated, but I'll tell you this. I was sitting in the river named Clarion on a water splash stone. And all afternoon, I listened to the voices of the river talking. Whenever the water struck a stone, it had something to say. And the water itself, and even the mosses settled under the water. And slowly, very slowly, it became clear to me what they were saying. Tell the river, I have a holiness. And I too, said the stranger. I too, went for the master in the true father. Theologians and biblical scholars alike love to wax poetic about the many images of gardens in our scriptures. Adam and Eve, starting one, Jesus, chose one, and the book of Revelation brings us right up to the root of the tree. So while gardens may frame our scriptures, our readings today highlight that a river runs through it. From the ancient waterway we know as the Tigris and Euphrates, across the Nile to the Red Sea, alongside the banks of the Jordan, the rivers of scripture tell our most profound stories of life, loss, and liberation. As Mary Oliver's poem reveals, our rivers and their waters have much to tell us. For as we know from both science of evolution and the college theory of the book of Genesis, waters were indeed the first wounds of life on our planet. They gave rise to the tiny little protozoa of complex plants and fish and animals, and finally they drew two-legged creatures to their banks. And as human communities grew up around rivers, so did the deep wisdom that waters are not just necessary for physical life, but for the life of the spirit as well. God is in the waters. God speaks through the waters. And we are invited to learn how to listen. So what do these waters have to say to us? Well, so much more than can say in a sermon. But we can start with this first profound truth. Water, not just a chemical compound, is literally alive. A single drop of fresh river water contains millions of organisms and nearly infinite numbers of bacteria essential to every form of life. Secondly, just like in human communities, waters tell us that diversity is the secret to a balanced community, a balanced ecosystem. Waters also tell us that they are healthiest when they are in motion, running over walls, falling down cliffs, lacking a detour. Stagnant waters become toxic and lifeless and home to disease. Swiftly moving waters keep the oxygen churning. Rivers need to breathe. And finally, they also teach us philosophy that change is the essential nature of things. As the Greek philosopher Heraclitus said, no man steps in the same river twice, for it is not the same river. He is not the same man. So much wisdom is found in the words beneath the waters. As some of you may know, my husband and I recently moved to a little cottage by the Delaware River, and it really was the river that drew us there. There is a different kind of rhythm of life that is felt. But while we cannot see it from our home, its presence is all around us. In the centuries-old house built from the river rock, the constant call of the migrating geese who make their home on its banks. Even the names of the towns and roads reflect the letting and often people's relationship to the river. And looking at that mighty current of the Delaware flowing, I'm reminded of the many rivers that have shaped our history, our cities, our lives, and yet how often to us they are just something to cross over on our way to get from here to there. But for sure, before we built highways and bridges across them, rivers represented some daunting thresholds into new realities. One of the most powerful themes in our scripture is of liberation that takes us through water, not just as a natural boundary, but as a profound rite of passage as well. But the Jordan River is perhaps the most central in our faith story. For it was the Jordan that the wandering Israelites finally crossed into the Promised Land after 40 years in the wilderness. And it was on its banks that we first meet John the Baptist, and then Jesus as he embarks on the ultimate threshold crossing into his new world. And God passed in the water, hearing God call him my beloved child for the first time. It was beside those waters that Jesus teaches and heals and refreshes the souls of those who have been thirsty for grace and life. For rivers are not just boundaries on a map, or a place to get drinking water or travel to noon. They are an active spiritual presence. They refresh not only our bodies but our souls, and whether it's the Delaware or the Jordan, rivers remind us that we are indeed creatures of a God-drenched water. It makes how we relate and treat our rivers so important. Important, but also very sobering. For we have not always treated them as the font of holiness that they are. If we were to visit the Jordan River today, we would see that those lush groves of date palms and tomato plants grown in that beautiful green river valley come at the expense of irrigation that dwindles the waters of that river, so that the Dead Sea itself is literally dying, evaporating away from it. And the same thing is happening in our great American rivers, like the Colorado in the Southwest, that's been diverted to grow crops in California's Central Valley and to power those gorgeous fountains along the Las Vegas Strip. This is the river that's part of the Green Canyon, yet in places it has been reduced to a trickle, at times unable to even reach the mouth from where it began. The salt from our majestic rivers are hard to acknowledge on a day when we are celebrating the beauty and bounty of God's creation. But we don't talk about them to paralyze ourselves in anger or in guilt, but to inspire a shift within us, a shift that enables us to work toward their restoration. And it's not just an optimistic dream. Our recent environmental history has shown us that change is possible. Some of you might remember those horrendous photos of the Cuyahoga River in Cleveland, which spontaneously combusted into flames in 1969 from all the chemical pollutants poured into it. Yet out of that awful experience came a new movement in our country to protect our environment, and the Clean Water was a direct result. Over the years since then, the Cuyahoga itself has been cleaned up substantially. The ecosystem surrounding it has become biologically rich and diverse once again. Nothing but evil has become. Its rhythm is being felt and heard again in the lives of the people who live on its banks. From that low point is literally a river on fire. Life can be renewed, restored. And isn't this the very promise of God, that all things can be made new? After he wipes out the world in the great flood, God makes a covenant with Noah and with us that the waters will no longer destroy, but will nourish and sustain the land. When we hear the echoes of that promise in the psalm today, and reading from the prophet Isaiah, and the story of the Samaritan woman at the well, God's presence in the waters and life-giving. In the restoration of the Cuyahoga River, we get a little glimpse of that image from Revelation, where the waters suddenly run clear and bright. There is no correction. There is nothing wrong with it. Picture that once polluted river of the Cuyahoga, now fresh and rejoicing. Picture a book graveling, great stone, a book battling, skipping over the rocks, with glee. Picture the Jordan flowing, bringing life back to the Dead Sea. Picture yourself sitting on a sun-splashed stone in the river, drenched in sunlight and spray, listening to the waters speak to you. For like Mary Oliver, we may not know who God is exactly, but we can know this. Beneath those waters are worlds sprinkled. That we too are beloved children of God, beloved from the moment of our birth, steeped in the waters of our baptism, and challenged now to keep our part of the promise. For we've been anointed to follow Jesus' wet footprints out of the river and into a world to care for, love, and rejoice in what God has created. To say of ourselves, I am part of holiness, and you are, and you are. Like the waters and the stone and the trailing moss. To remember that we have come from waters billions of years ago and on the very day of our death, and that we are part of a holy continuum of apologetics. This is where we are headed. This is our calling. For like that river that runs through the book of Revelation, our destiny is to be about healing and peacemaking, partnering with God to make all things new again. We have the ability. We have the knowledge. Now we must find the will to cross thresholds of our denial and complacency and slip into the ever-changing flow of the current, to be agents of creative hope and joy, to shift our thinking from scarcity and exploitation and instead believe in the possibility of restoration, of new life, and to commit ourselves to keeping the promise God has made with us. Celebrate that promise, gathering together with the river, dancing to the river of the rhythm of creation. May it be so today. May it be so always.
Have a full choir back. Please stand if you are able for our closing commission. For the Spirit of God is upon us. God has anointed us to bear good news to the afflicted, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom to the captive, to open the prison to those who are bound. Let us go forth in the name of Christ to bring peace into broken relationships, healing to alienated persons, and justice into oppressive structures. Amen.
And we want the joy, peace, and love to continue after this service. So please do join us for coffee hour in the Guild Room, especially if you're brand new. We hope you will, so that we'll get to know you a bit better. You just head outside the out of the sanctuary, take a left in the narthex. Got a couple of ushers posted to guide you to the Guild Room. We do hope you will join us. So our worship here has ended, but our service has just begun. As we go from this place into a world that is parched for the love and the grace and the mercy of God, let us be rivers of holiness where they are so needed. And as we go, let us remember that we always travel with the love of God, the peace of Christ, the strength and the power of the Holy Spirit, this day and always. Amen. Thank you.